Recording in progress.
So, if there is no question, okay. So today we are going to discuss a bit about limit cycles, what we introduced last time, and try to say something a little bit more general. Now, in the concerning the fixed points, we studied like many models and we introduced many effects, etc. Now the part of the limit cycle and the following part, which probably will start today, is not going to be that dense in terms of calculation. And the main reason why it's not going to be dense in terms of calculation is that there is not much we can do in terms of calculation. So basically, the main thing we are going to try to cover, at least in the first part of the lecture, and it's what we're going to cover about limit cycle, is what they are, and we sort of already said that, and what are the conditions to that we can use to know whether they are not present, basically, to exclude their presence. And that's more or less, that's all, right? We're not going to do weird calculation that allow us to say something about the shape of the limit cycle. That is basically impossible in most of the cases. Okay? Okay. So, we already said this last time, limit cycles are periodic oscillations, and these periodic oscillations, contrary to neutral cycle, to like the harmonic oscillator pendulum kind of behavior, this cycle have a very defined amplitude, which is attractive. So basically, if we start, it doesn't need to be attractive, but they have a precise amplitude. So if we start slightly away from that, and that limit cycle is stable, we tend to go to that amplitude, and that is going to stay there on that amplitude forever. While if we have a harmonic oscillator, the amplitude is determined by the initial. Okay. Good. So the question I want to answer, as I said, is when are we sure that there are not going to be limit cycles? So one condition where, so in general, we are thinking about like a dynamics x I not equal to x I of x. Okay, and we want to know when we can exclude the presence of the limit cycle. So one case where we can exclude the presence of a limit cycle is if there is a potential. So as we said multiple times, in dimensions higher than one, we are not guaranteed that there is a potential, but if we can write xi dot as minus dv over dxi, then we can prove that there is no limit cycle. How do we prove it? Well, let's prove it by contradiction. So let's assume that there is a limit cycle. Now, if there is a limit cycle, there is an oscillatory behavior with some period t. Okay? So let's assume that there is an oscillatory behavior with some period capital T. So that means that if there is like a if there is a limit cycle with period t, okay, what do we have? We have that if you calculate the integral between 0 and t of any if we take any function, let's say u, which is a scalar function of x, if there is such a limit cycle, then u of x t must be equal to u of x 0, right? By definition. Because if there is a limit cycle of period t, x of t is equal to x of 0. Okay? This clearly implies that x of t is equal to x of 0. On the other hand, if we have these dynamics, what we can say is that we can calculate dv as the 0 and t, okay, of, so this is v of xt minus v of x0, and this is just the derivative over t, so use the derivative, okay, and t, which of course can be written as the sum over I of dv dxi xi dot t, okay, but this is equal to what? This is equal to minus x dot I, okay, so this is equal to the integral between 0 and t of minus the sum over I of x I dot squared into t, so minus the integral between 0 and t of x dot into t. Okay? So what's the issue here is that if there is an init cycle, this has to be equal to 0. Okay, but notice that this is equal to 0, so this is always negative, but in particular it's not always not positive, but in particular this is equal to 0 only if x dot is equal to 0, okay, sorry, x dot I is equal to 0 for every I. So this can be equal to 0 only if xi dot is equal to 0, so if we are a fixed point, right? But this is incompatible with a limit cycle. Okay? So if we have a limit cycle, so we check under what conditions the value of the potential the given time capital T is equal to 0. And we discover that this can be equal to 0 only if the derivative of x is equal to 0 for all the x, okay? Which of course implies that then it's possible only if there is a fixed point. So this is incompatible with a limit cycle. Right? If you have, I didn't say that explicitly, but if you have a limit cycle, xi dot is never equal to 0 for all the i's, right? It's not a fixed point. But the points are continuously changing. Is this clear?
Why is it called a potential? In physics, is the second derivative of x.
Yes, we sort of discussed this. The reason is that in physics you. It's not the same potential, that's the short answer. What is a potential in physics when you have a system in higher dimension is that you have equations like, let me write it this way. So you have x dot equal to v, okay, and v dot equal to minus du d xi, for instance. Okay? So this is what is a potential in physics. Okay? But remember that what we showed is that if you write equations like these equations are conservative systems, so a system for which it exists a function whose value doesn't change over time. Okay. And that, for instance, in this case, in general, you don't have that property. Actually, in these cases, when you have a potential in this sense, in the sense of nonlinear dynamics, if you look at dv over dt, that's always negative, right? Over time, you are always decreasing. So this function here is always decreasing, so it's a dissipative system. Okay. If you want to have an analogy with physics, you can think of this as what is called sometimes Aristotelian dynamics, as opposed to Galilean dynamics. So it's a system that is overdamped, where you have friction, basically. If friction dominates over inertia, then basically you can you have equations that are like these, right? Okay. And if inertia doesn't count compared to friction, so, okay, if this dominates over this, okay, you have exactly the equation that you have there. Any question? Okay. So I mean, it's not. This difference is one of the fundamental reasons why you don't see typically limit cycles in mechanics, because you typically deal with system where you have a conserved quantity, and when you have a conserved quantity, what you have are like neutral cycles. Okay. Good. Another condition that actually can be shown in a way that is completely analogous to this is if you have a weaker condition that having a potential. So another condition when there are no limit cycles is if there is a Lyapunov function. Okay? So if there is a Lyapunov function, so what is a Lyapunov function? Well, it's a function L of x star, L of x, such that L of x is, you can always define it such that it's positive for all the x. So it's a function that has this property, and dl dt is always negative, and it's equal to zero only if then if you have a Lyapunov function and you have this function that decreases, you don't have closed orbits. So you can show this in a very similar way, but also you can think, I mean, if you want to use this to translate also this case to an intuitive example, is if you have a function that always decreases over time, the value decreases over time unless you are in a fixed point, like this, and you have an orbit, right, a closed orbit, I mean, this function can only be constant, right? But this function is only constant if you are in a fixed point, part of the Lyapunov function. So it means that you are in a then if you are in a, it's equal to zero in a fixed point, then you don't have a limit cycle. Okay? Is it clear what I said? Or not? Yes. Okay.
Can you explain it again?
Okay. So the Lyapunov function so the Lyapunov function is a function such that you the key point is that so the Lyapunov function, I mean, you need to have this condition and having the you have this condition, right? So that means that you have a function and the value of this function decreases always over time. The value of this function decreases always over time, and when this function does not decrease over time, it means that you have a fixed point, or a set of fixed points. Okay? The reason is that you can always write the L t equal to the sum over I dl psi, xi dot. Okay? Oh, sorry, yes, that's why it was, okay. So, and this function needs to be, needs needs to be convex, right? At least locally it has to be. Yes. Okay. So let's say let's start from this example. Let's assume that this function is convex, right? So you have a unique minimum, okay, or a unique set of minima. Okay. Now, the fact that this function always decreases over time, it implies that you go toward the point where this quantity is equal to zero, right? So to the minima of the dynamics. Okay. You go to all the points that are the minimum of the dynamic, the minima of the Lyapunov function, and those points are the points where xi dot is equal to zero, so the fixed points. Okay. So the key point is that if you have a Lyapunov function, the value of the function always decreases, you go toward the minima, and the minima are the fixed points. Now, if you have a limit cycle, what happens? It happens that you change continuously the value of x, right, on a closed orbit. But now, this closed orbit is not a fixed point. Okay. So this quantity is not equal to zero. Okay. And this quantity is, in general, not equal to zero because you are changing the... Okay. So then it means that if you continuously change the value of the function, the dynamics in that point, it must be a fixed point. So it cannot be a limit cycle. Okay. Did I make it more confusing? Yes. Okay. Well,
sorry.
Yes.
But we have to say also that the Lyapunov function decreases on the trajectory factories. So L of x of t, dt is less than zero.
Yes, this is always negative, is non-zero on the trajectories unless you have a fixed point, right? This is the
yes.
So that means that if you are on a limit cycle, the function, you're not on a fixed point, so the function has to decrease. But since it's always decreasing, and you are in a closed orbit, you are going to need to get up to the initial point. So it can continuously decrease on a closed orbit. This is what you were saying.
Yes.
So what is confusing except the fact that I make it more confusing than what it is? I don't know if to move on or try to stay in this local minimum of the Lyapunov function. Is it clear now or not? Yes. Okay, so if you can find the Lyapunov function, you know that you're going to go toward the fixed points. Okay. Now, there is another criterion to check. Whether there is or not a fixed point, which is called Dulac criterion, and it's different from finding a Lyapunov function, but there's an analogy to it. I'm not going to cover this. I mean, just saying that there is something like that. Well, basically, you have to find a function and check that in a given region of the space, the value of this function doesn't change over time. So it's something, a weaker condition than a Lyapunov function, in some sense. And I don't want to say anything more. I mean, you can find it in the books by Strogatz in chapter 8. But the point is that basically these are the way to exclude the possibility of complete cycle. And what is in common between these three cases is that, in some sense, you don't, this is something I already said, you don't have a constructive way to construct these, don't have a constructive way to construct these functions. Okay? So if I give you a dynamical system, you cannot have a general way to say, oh, I have a plug and play method to say there is not limit cycle. Okay? So you can check, in some cases you can do that, you can check the fixed points, their stability, but if you are not able to find a Lyapunov function, if you are not able to check this criterion and the system doesn't have a potential, you cannot be 100% sure that there is not a limit cycle. Okay? So there could always be a limit cycle, and then of course the matter becomes much more numerical that you have to check cross conditions. These are the sort of scenarios, the way to check if there is not a limit cycle. So if you find a Lyapunov function, then you know that there is no limit cycle. Yes?
The inverse is also true. If there is a limit cycle, that means
there is
no limit cycle, that would mean that there is a Lyapunov.
No. So of course the inverse is true. If there is, the inverse in the sense that if there is a limit cycle, you know that there is no Lyapunov function.
Yeah.
But because then you have a function that, let's say, there is no function that you can construct that doesn't increase over the closed orbits, right? Because that function has to oscillate as well. And it cannot be constant because you are not on a fixed point.
And you know, if there is no limit cycles, that doesn't mean that there is a Lyapunov function.
If there is no limit cycle,
I mean, we would say, okay.
Yes, if there is no limit cycle, it doesn't mean that there is not a, yes, there could not be a Lyapunov function as well.
Okay.
So you could have a case when you have a fixed point, but there is no Lyapunov function. For instance, if you have multiple fixed points, that's the case. Or more general, in practical terms, most of the time, the point is not that there is no Lyapunov function, it's that you don't have a way to construct it. So you don't have a way to find it. Okay, so it's not possible to find. Any other question? Okay, so now in two dimensions, as I said the other time, there is a case in two dimensions. There are conditions where you can be sure that there is a limit cycle. But this applies only to two dimensions. To higher dimension, the situation is different. And the situation is the following. So, so this is the statement of the theorem that I mentioned last time. So this is. And basically, suppose that you have a given, you have R, which is a closed subset of the plane. So we are in two dimensions. And you have a closed subset. You have I don't know why I'm writing points, but you have some dynamical system xi dot equal to fi of x, and there are no fixed points in this region. So there are no fixed points, not that they are not stable. There are really no fixed points, and that there is a trajectory. Let's say C that is confined in R. Then basically C is a closed orbit or these four conditions, there is an insight. So C is a closed orbit or spiral toward it. So you tends to converge toward it in long times. Okay. So that means you have a region of the plane, and in this region, this is a closed region, is a closed subset. And all the trajectory, you know that if you start inside this region, you are not going to go out, basically. It's different from that. If you, you know that there is a trajectory that is confined over that, so that if you start inside a given point, you are not going to go out. Okay? But there is no fixed point. Then you know that basically the trajectory that you obtained by starting from that point, and then you know that you're not going to go out, is either a limit cycle, is a closed orbit, or tends to a closed orbit in the long time, in the long diagram. Okay. So for instance, this is what we used last time to show that there is, we didn't say that, but the reason why we are sure that the in the model we considered last time, there is a limit cycle is because of this theory. Okay. So in that case, what we have, we are in the scenario where we have three fixed points, okay? And then what we know is that, you remember that if you start from point large enough, you tend to go back, right? The calculation we did last time. So what is the closed region? Well, I can define that, one can define the closed region, which is something like this. Okay, so the sort of color points here. Okay, you can define the closed subset of the space, and you know that if you start inside here, you're not gonna go inside this bubble, if this is small enough, but you can define a value that is small enough, because this is repulsive, okay? And you are gonna not go toward the axis because they are also repulsive, right? So you know that if you start in a point here, the point is gonna be confined in that region for all the times, so there must be at least one limit cycle. Any question about this? Now, I guess also today we're going to discover why this is not true anymore in three dimensions. But in two dimensions, basically, there are what this shows is that in two dimensions there are only two things that can happen: either there are fixed points or there are limit cycles. Okay? Or if you want, there is a third where the system diverges to infinity. These are the only things that can happen, right? And in some sense, the only thing you can do is to study the stability of these kind of attractors, right? You can check whether fixed points are stable or not stable, and whether the cycle are stable or not stable. And then, interesting, surprising phenomena emerge when you are close to these bifurcation points. So you're close to the points where these attractors lose stability. So when fixed points becomes not stable anymore, or when a limit cycle becomes not stable anymore. Okay? Any question about this? In that case, if that is a potential, that those are all fixed points, right? Because in those points, in those minima, okay, the x dot is equal to zero.
Okay? So it would be like.
So it's true also for the I deleted it, but I mean, when you write dvdt, okay, this is the sum over I dv dxi dot. So in that case, I don't know, in that case, when you have a Mexican head and you have, that is a potential, basically all those points there are fixed points of the dynamics. Okay, so they are fixed points. Right? So that means that how do I draw a Mexican head now? Let's look at a Mexican head from above. So you have the fixed points, right? And these are the bottom of the potential, right? You have all these fixed points that go around. Now these are fixed points, so it means that if you start here and you are like here, then you stop here because the derivative of xi are all equal to zero there. Okay? So you don't move. And the same is here. So they are all fixed points, which means that you go there and you stop. By definition, if you have a limit cycle, along the trajectories, x dot needs to be equal to zero at least for some components, because you change x. So if you think if you are on a if you are on a limit cycle, right, like x and y, but if you look at x over time, we do some trajectories, right? This is x versus time. Of course, I mean, if you look at x dot versus time, this is also doing something, right? So this is, it will be something doing something like this. Right? So x dot is always changing over time on a limit cycle. This is true also, I mean, for any oscillation, right? Unless you have a fixed point. I mean, the definition of a fixed point is exactly what x dot is equal to zero all the time for all the components. On a limit cycle, it's always changing. Right. But the point is that the minima of the potential or the minimum of the Lyapunov function are the points, are the fixed points. Okay? Like, if these are the fixed points, then it means that x dot I is equal to zero for all the I. Okay. So it means that you arrive there and you stop. Now, then you can ask a different question, what if I have some perturbation, etc. Well, these are all fixed points, right? And they are, I mean, you can move between these fixed points because you have perturbation and you move it between these fixed points, but that's a different point. Okay. Is this clear or not?
Yes.
So you can have, the question is, because your question is, you can have a dynamical system where you have many fixed points, and these fixed points occupy a closed region, a closed region of the space, right? So something that looks like a closed orbit. But these are all fixed points, so it means that when you end up in one of those, you stop there. Any question?
And what if we have like a local minimum?
If it is a local minimum, it means that you, depending on the initial condition, you arrive there or not.
Like a Mexican hat with one...
Mexican hat with what?
One of the two minima.
Something like this?
Yeah.
Well, it means that if you start here, you end up here. Right? Of course, I mean, there is also the rotation here. Depending on when you start, you end up in one of these points in the circle. If you start here, you end up in the minimum of the circle. Okay. Now, in this case, there is not a Lyapunov function, right? I mean, because you, depending on when you start, the Lyapunov function, you don't end up always in the minimum of the function, right? Because you end up here or here. Okay. No, there is a Lyapunov. There is. It's not complex. the potential. But where you go depends on where you start from. Okay? Is it clear?
Yeah.
So it's just a generalization of that. But in this case, you have a potential, you don't have closed orbits. That's why you don't have limit cycles. So that's why limit cycles are a little bit unintuitive if you think about dynamics as something that happens in a potential. We used a lot this view of, or you have a potential in one dimension, it's very useful, right? But also in other dimensions. You have a view that you have some potential in the nonlinear dynamic sense, and basically you have your dynamics drives toward the bottom of this potential well. Right. And you start in a given point and you go to the minimum that is in the basin of attraction where you start from. Okay. This is something that is true only if you have a potential. Okay. And nonlinear dynamical systems with a potential are very peculiar systems. Okay. When you don't have a potential, like in the case we considered last time, okay, then there are other phenomena that can happen, and limit cycles is one of them. And there is no way you can understand a limit cycle with a picture of a potential in mind. It's not something that is driven by potential.
How do you know that the amplitude is constant?
Well, that's the definition of the potential, of the limit cycle.
Yeah, but how we know that?
Well, I mean, what's the alternative?
It's not constant.
Okay, but then it's not constant. I mean, how do you draw a trajectory that is closed and the amplitude is not constant? I mean, how do you say that it does not depend on the initial condition?
It's always the same.
Well, I mean, in some sense, is a definition of what a limit cycle is.
Right.
I say limit cycle is a closed orbit stable amplitude, if you want, over time. So it's a closed orbit which is stable, right? And then it's thanks to Poincaré and Bendingson. If I know that, if this condition applies, that's what is going to happen.
Okay, so there is, I suppose the proof is in the book that it follows.
Huh?
The proof of the theorem is in the book that it follows.
The proof is quite complicated.
And the other way of doing it, I suppose, would be like making a computational.
Well, numerically, okay. So of course that's a completely different approach, right? But numerically, what you do is fairly simple. You start with the initial condition. Let's say you start with some value of x, okay, and y in this case. And what you see is that if you look at x versus time, what you see is that you see something weird, and then you see a periodic behavior, okay, and the same for x. Okay. If you look at the plane, what you see is that you see that they are moving around, and then they repeat the orbit all the time. Okay. So you plot x versus y, two dimensions it's easy, right? You plot x versus y, and you see that they converge to the same value. Okay. Then if you want, you can start numerically. What you can do is that you can start with different initial conditions, and you can see whether you go on that point or not. So in practical terms, what you typically do is the following. You take your system, find the fixed points, understand whether they're stable or not. This gives you the range of parameters where this picture might change. There might be more clear. And then you choose a value of parameters and you simulate and you see what happens to the system. But I think that the key point, and this emerges thanks to the question, so is to understand that this is not something you can think in terms of potential. Right? It's not something where you have a Mexican net, you go to the minimum and you move around. Right? It's completely different from that. And there is no way to understand it. By definition, there is no way to understand it in terms of I have some scalar function of the variables and I go toward the minimum of that function. Any other question about the limit cycle? I mean, about what we said so far? Okay. So the last thing I want to say about limit cycle, limit cycles is just that whatever we said about bifurcations in one dimension can be generalized to dimensions, and for the sake of fixed points is the same story. So basically, if you look at fixed points, you have the same type of bifurcation, transcritical, pitchfork, blah blah blah. Now, when you have limit cycles, though, you can have higher types of fixed points, and basically, you have all the ones for fixed points, but then you can have new bifurcations that involve limit cycles. Okay? So, I'm going to be very qualitative here, but for instance, one of the most important bifurcations involving limit cycle is called off bifurcation. Again, I'll be qualitative here. The point is that you have, let's say, some parameter mu, which controls the bifurcation. And for negative mu, you have some attractive fixed points, and that's it. And for positive mu, the fixed point is unstable, and you have a stable limit cycle. Okay? And if you want, the typical radius of these limit cycles is order square root of mu. Okay? So, what I hear is that these limit cycles, the radius tends to zero when mu tends to zero, so the bifurcation point. And the key point is that you have fixed points, then these fixed points become unstable, and the moment where it becomes unstable, you have a limit cycles that emerge from it. Right? And as you increase the parameters, the radius of the limit cycle becomes larger and larger. Okay? So, if you are below the bifurcation, you spiral toward the fixed points, which is attractive. Above, you spiral away, but you end up in this orbit. And, something that I didn't say is that, in this case, you can imagine to expand in the same way as you obtain the normal forms, you can expand the dynamics of the limit cycle around the fixed point. And when you expand something, a limit cycle around the fixed point is always a circle. For the same reason why when you expand anything, the first term is always linear, this implies that basically it's always a circle. But close to the fixed point, you can approximate this as a circle. So this is one type of bifurcation. You have other types of bifurcation. So for instance, so this is the supercritical off. Then you have a subcritical version of bifurcation, where basically you have for mu larger than zero, you are in the same situation, so you have an unstable fixed point and a stable limit cycle, but below you have point, another stable limit cycle, and another stable limit cycle around. And what happens in that case is that the subcritical, the radius of this becomes smaller and smaller. Okay. So what happens when you go on the transition is that as you move on the transition, if you were at the very close to the fixed point, then you go to a limit cycle that has a finite radius as a function of mu. So this R is order 1. So let's say that you move, so in this case, if you look at the amplitude of the limit cycle, as you change the parameter mu, the value of the limit, the amplitude of the limit cycle is zero, and then becomes not zero continuously. In this case, it's zero, and then it jumps to the one that is outside, so you have a jump of the amplitude. This is just to get an idea of what kind of bifurcation you have. And then, you have a whole set of bifurcations that involve multiple limit cycles and don't involve fixed points. Okay? So you can imagine that you have like a limit cycle within another limit cycle, which is unstable, and then one of the two, they lose stability, they change stability, they collapse, these kind of things that don't involve fixed points. So it's not, I have a fixed point, I linearize, goes away, but I have like limit cycles and they lose stability at certain points. And these are called global bifurcations, the way they're called. And it becomes much more complicated. So the simple classifications we had for fixed points basically ends up here when you introduce the off bifurcation, and then it adds to the previous bifurcation. But then there are a whole new set of bifurcations that can emerge, which are much more complicated, and that involve like limit cycles and not fixed points. Any question about this?
On subcritical one, the left one is to recycle or?
The left one, yes, it's a fixed point, stable fixed point, unstable limit cycle, and a stable limit cycle. And what happens as you move the bifurcation parameter, this larger fixed limit cycle does not change. It's about constant. While this, the amplitude of this decreases. And when this decreases, this becomes unstable. So what's the point? The point is that when you cross the bifurcation point here, okay, this point becomes unstable, and the trajectory go to the limit cycle that is outside. Okay? So suppose that you look at the, let's say, the amplitude of oscillations as a function of the of mu. Okay? So you look at, I mean, now, I'm sort of assuming that these are circles. In general, they are not circles. If they are circles, I can't define what is the amplitude. But let's say that I have a measure of how far you are from the fixed points in your oscillation. So how wide the oscillation side compared to the average value over time. So in this case, what happens is that, okay, so here you have mu equal to zero. So below zero, the amplitude of oscillations is zero. And then it starts decreasing continuously from zero. Okay. Actually, something like this because it's square root of mu. While in the subcritical case, you are zero, right? If you start close to the fixed point, I'm always looking at the fixed point. But then, and then at this, you jump toward a larger amplitude. So this is discontinuous.
part of the question. Before zero, you had also the other arm.
Here you also have this, yes, if you start here, and yes. So this is the amplitude of oscillations, assuming that you start very close to the fixed point.
Okay.
So it's always with respect to the fixed points, the fixed point. Right. I'm always talking about bifurcations as referred to fixed points, so local bifurcations. You start very close to a fixed point, and these fixed points lose stability. And in the 1D cases, we saw what happens when you have only fixed points and you lose stability and you have like transcritical, pitchfork, saddle node, etc. Now, the fact that you have also limit cycles, there are bifurcations that involve limit cycles in one sense, that you have still a fixed point, these fixed points lose stability, but then the trajectories converge to limit cycles instead of converging to another fixed point. And these are the way this can happen in these two scenarios. Any other question? Okay, so I think we can take a 10-minute break and come back and
Recording stopped.
Okay.
Recording in progress.
Okay. Any question about limit cycles, bifurcations with limit cycles, bifurcations without limit cycles? Okay. So, to summarize once again what we have seen so far in our journey through dynamical systems is that basically if you are in one or two dimensions, there are these two things that can happen, either fixed points, can be stable or unstable, and limit cycles, right, with a constant amplitude, etc., etc. And you, as you move to three dimensions, you can ask whether is there something new that can happen or not. And the answer, of course, as most of my questions is rhetorical question, is yes, there is something new that happened. And I want to briefly introduce this something else that happened, and which is chaos. And we will not, I mean, one could do a course, a class only on that topic, and we are going to do alpha lecture. So, but the point is I think it's very important to know what we're talking about, how it presents, and then there are endless mathematical results and endless work on these topics to prove theorems, to understand properties, and there are many, many other questions, but we are not going to touch on those. Okay? So the way I'm going to introduce it is, in some sense, in the way it was discovered. And this was, other people have noticed this kind of behavior in the past, especially Poincaré studying the triple body problem. But this term and this the existence of chaos emerged in the 60s when people started using calculators. And the guy that basically is responsible for part of these discoveries is a guy named Lorentz. There are like 3,000 Lorentz, and they vary because they have the T or the Z, or not the T, but this is one of those. He was actually interested in modeling atmosphere, so it was running a model model atmosphere, and this was a three-dimensional model. I don't remember what this variable represent, but it's not important for the discussion I want to make. So it was a three-dimensional dynamical system, and it is pretty simple. I mean, it involves, so this is, for instance, linear. This is quadratic in the variable, and this is quadratic in the variable as well. And it depends on two parameters, three parameters, sigma, r, and v, which are all positive parameters. Okay. So, before saying what he found out and what it happened with this calculator, let's suppose that we have this dynamical system. What can we do with this? We're going to first start fixed points, right? With a lot of excitement. And if you study fixed points, I'll be fast in these calculations because we know how to study fixed points. But what are the fixed points? Well, you realize that all the terms are linear or quadratic in the variables. So there is a fixed point 0, 0, 0. And then so this is a fixed point, then if r is larger than 1, there is another fixed point that is called x star equal to y star equal to plus or minus b r minus 1 and z star equal to r minus 1. Okay. And these fixed points, there are two of them, right? Depending on whether you have a plus or a minus. These are called sometimes c plus and c minus. Okay. There is a pitch for bifurcation when you go from r lower than 1 to r larger than 1. You start from one fixed point and you end up with three fixed points. And you can check the stability of these. So, and you realize so this is stability. So, you realize that 0, 0, 0 is globally stable if r is lower than 1. What does it mean globally stable? It's locally stable, so if you have perturbation you go back, but actually it's local globally stable, meaning that if you start from any initial condition you end up over 0, and you can show that because L x, y, z equal to 1 over sigma x squared plus y squared plus z squared is a Lyapunov function. So there is this function here, which is a Lyapunov function if r is lower than 1. Okay? So if you, how do you check this? You take this function, you calculate dl/dt by applying the chain rule and using these equations, and you're going to discover that this is lower or equal than 0 if r is lower than 1. Okay? And then, you check the stability of these C plus and minus, these two fixed points are both locally stable if one is lower than R, lower than RH. Where RH is a function of the parameters. I can write it if you want to simulate this on the computer. So this is sigma plus b minus 3, or if you want to do the calculation and check, something like this. Okay?
Is it r plus 1?
No, here it's 1. Rh, it's an h.
Let's put here.
H. Okay? If you want, let's call it RC. Okay? So there is a critical point of R which is larger than 1. Here I'm also assuming that sigma is larger than b minus 1. Okay? So there is a critical point, and this fixed point is locally stable if this parameter R is smaller than this parameter RC and is larger than 1. Okay? So, below this, below 1, you start from an initial condition, you end up with this fixed point. Between 1 and RC, you start from a given point and you end up either in C plus or in C minus. Okay? In those, these two fixed points. Now the question is, what happens for R larger than RH? Actually, one discovers that there is an initiator, but the initiator is always unstable. So something else happens. Okay. And this is what we're going to discuss now. Before saying what happens, what Lorentz was doing, because people knew about some properties about these attractors, they knew that that it was something that appeared like not a fixed point in that regime. They didn't appear the limit cycles, but the properties were not very investigated. And what he discovered, and that puzzled his mind, was that he was doing these numerical simulations. And at the time, you were doing this numerical simulation, and you had prints out of the points of the trajectory, right? So imagine that you have these simulations and you print the point of x at any given value. And then what he did is that for some reasons, because he was not sure that if the system was going to go down, etc., he saved one condition in the middle. Okay? And then he had the sort of simulations going on. And then it started with a simulation with the same value, another simulation with the same value he stopped from. Okay, with exactly the same value. And what happens is that he then ran again the program, exactly the same program, and he found completely different results. He found that the trajectory generated were completely different. And what he understood was that the precision of the computer was like 10 to the minus 6, while the precision of the prints out was 10 to the minus 3. Okay? I mean, he knew that, but everyone, I think also everyone here would believe that this would not be a problem. You have a very, some finite precision, but you should not expect to have completely different results for this precision, right? You expect to have like errors of the same order of what you put in. But instead found completely different results. And that was the beginning of like the discovery of chaotic systems, which are now briefly described. The idea, what happens if you do a trajectory of this system and you plot it over time? So let's say that you simulate this and you simulate these dynamics for R larger than RH. What you see is that if you look at, let's say, X, what you see is that you see a trajectory that changes over time and doesn't appear to have any regularity. Okay. You don't see a cycle, you don't see something that repeats, you don't see repetitions, you see a dynamics that continuously change value, and if you take any chunk, it doesn't repeat equally to itself any time in the future. Okay? You don't see any regularity. In some sense, it appears very similar to what you obtain if you were generating a stochastic dynamics. So suppose that you were rolling a dice at every time step and adding some noise to some dynamics. What you would observe are trajectories where the trajectory you generate don't repeat themselves, right? Because you always generate noise. Okay. The difference here is that this is a purely deterministic dynamics. There is no stochasticity. It's purely deterministic. And if you look at the dynamics in the three-dimensional space, what you see is that you have the fixed point here that is unstable, 0, 0, and then C plus and C minus. And basically you see trajectories, you have some sort of transients, and then you go around here, and then around here, like this, you stay. Do something like this, much better, much nicer than this. Right? And the point is that these are trajectories where you have deterministic trajectories, okay, but they appear not to have any repetition over time, they don't converge to any fixed point. Okay? And one of the most important properties of these trajectories is the one that was discovered by Lorentz. And so the important properties of this trajectory is that suppose that you start from x of t, you run a simulation, you run it for a while, and then you have a given x of t. Right? So you are, in some sense, on this attractor. Okay? You start from some x of t, and then you run two simulations, one continuing the simulation for x of t, and one where you have a small perturbation, a small initial perturbation. Okay? Let's do this. So you start with a given initial condition x of 0, and then you start with another initial condition, x of 0 plus a small perturbation, and you want to know what happens to x of t and what happens to x of t plus delta of t. Okay? And the idea is that you start with some delta of 0, which is much smaller than 1. Okay? What happens in these systems is that if you track delta of t over time, this delta of t is proportional to delta of 0, but increase exponentially over time with some exponent, which is positive, so it's some positive exponent. Okay. Now this exponent is what is called the Lyapunov exponent. It's not the in general, in this case, it's not the eigenvalue, even if I call it lambda, it's not the eigenvalue of the linear stability analysis. It is if this is negative, so if this is negative, you converge, same thing, but in this case it's not. Right? You tend to diverge exponentially in time. So that means that what happened to poor Lorentz was that he was starting to two very close initial conditions, but then since he was on this chaotic system, the two trajectories diverge one to the other exponentially over time. Okay? And so even if they started very close, they became more and more different. Okay. To be more precise, if you simulate numerically this equation, and you do this thing, you sort of plot the log, let's say, of delta of t divided by delta of 0, okay? So what you see over time, what you see is that this grows linearly, right? And the slope is lambda, because this is the argument of the log grows exponentially. Then there is a point for very, very large t where this has a plateau, okay? And the reason is the following, is that you, basically what happens here is that you start here from two points that are very close to each other, and what happens is that their trajectory is going to diverge over time, so they become more and more different. You lose the memory of the fact that they were very close at the beginning, and so they, at the end, after a long time, they occupy two positions, two uncorrelated positions in this phase plane. What I mean two uncorrelated positions is that it's like if you were drawing two random points in this attractor. Okay? But then if you draw two random points, their difference doesn't increase anymore over time. Okay? So it cannot increase forever over time, if you want, because this occupies a finite region of the space. Okay? So the point is that you lose memory over time. So if you try to do the simulation, you're going to find something like this. But the interesting part is not the saturation. The interesting part is that you I mean, if you have two trajectories that start very close, basically in a time which is over 1 over lambda, they already diverged, right? They are very different from each other. Which means that if you try to predict where the trajectory is going to be in the future, you need to, you cannot predict reliably the future, because all the small errors you have in the present are going to expand over time. Okay? So suppose that you know that your system behaves in this way, that this equation is what regulates your system, and then you have measures about x, y, and z at a given time, you know the parameters. If you do any small error, that error that you had at the beginning in the measurement is going to increase over time, and it's going to make your prediction unreliable. Even if you knew precisely the equation, you knew precisely your parameters. If you just have an error on the initial condition, that is going to drive a completely different prediction. And that's why weather forecast for more than 3-4 days doesn't work. Right? Fundamentally, because you have a system, the atmosphere, which is turbulent, it's chaotic, okay? And therefore you can have very, very precise measures of the pressure, the temperature, in many, many positions, but you still have finite errors, and these finite errors are going to drive toward the big errors in the future. Okay. Any question about this? Yes, your question.
I don't know if I understood. You said that if I add an error at the beginning, this will grow exponentially, like the... Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, yes. So that means, suppose that this is the true value,
uh-huh.
Okay, but then you have a measure which is not infinitely precise, so you have something like this. So then you want to check what is your prediction compared to this, to the reality, and the difference between the two is going to grow as much. Okay. Any other question? So, the point is that, surprisingly, there is no universally accepted definition of chaos. But for what can interest us, there are good enough definition. So, I mean, a good operational definition that I think it's useful for you is that it's deterministic. So it's governed by equations that are deterministic. There is no stochasticity. It's sensitive to initial condition, what I say there, so that if you start with two different conditions, they tend to diverge exponentially over time, and then there is an aperiodic long behavior, meaning that you don't have, you still have an attractor, so independently of the initial condition, you end up toward long time to a subset of the possible points, okay? But this behavior is aperiodic, so you don't have a limit cycle and you don't have a fixed point. But still you have a well-defined long time view. A big deal of the research on the chaotic system is to characterize these attractors, also topologically. Okay? So I used a lot the word attractor. The idea, I think it's useful to say what I mean with attractor in a more formal way. So, in general, we use the word attractor, and the idea is that they are attractors is a set of points that are invariant over time. So it's a set of points that if you start with that set of points, right, and you integrate the dynamics, okay, you the dynamics starting from any of these set of points always is containing this set of points. Okay. So any trajectory, let's say if you have an attractor A, any trajectory and you start with any point X in A, X of T is in A for every T. Okay? So it doesn't map, you start with a point, it doesn't map outside the attractor. It attracts on the open set of initial conditions, meaning that if you start let's say if you start with an x of 0 that is in this open set and this x of 0 in that open set, then the distance from x of t to, let's say, the distance from the x of t to the attractor A, okay, decreases over time for large times. Okay? So meaning that if you start on A, there is an open set of initial conditions, and over time you tend to become closer and closer to this attractor. If you start away, so it attracts some initial conditions, and 3 is minimal, so there is no subset of A that satisfies 1 and 2. Okay? So you have this point that satisfies 1 and 2, there is no point you can remove, and then the subset you get it still satisfies 1 and 2, so it's the minimal set of points of 2. Now, we can easily realize that fixed points are invariant over time, attract, if they are stable, attract an open set of initial conditions, and are minimal. Limit cycles fall in this trajectory as well. And the idea is that chaotic attractors, which are called strange attractors, so this gives us an idea of how well understood they are in some sense. So the strange attractors are the attractors that are attractors with very sensitive that are very sensitive to initial conditions. So, like the property we described here, okay? So, these attractors that when you start from two slightly different initial conditions and you look over time, they map to very different points inside the attractor or close to the attractor, okay? Now, to give you an idea, there is no formal proof, I think, or there was very recently, I'm not sure. There is no formal proof, let's say, plus or minus 10 years, that the Lorentz attractor is a strange attractor. Actually, there is no proof that is an attractor, so that in particular that is minimal. Okay? And this is like the most known chaotic system. Okay? So let me say just a couple of things before we stop. One point that I wanted to say is yet again that there are many things that are not known, and there are many, let's say, beautiful properties of these attractors. So in particular, these attractors have a very interesting topological structure. They are typically fractal, which means that if you start on a point on this attractor, you take a bubble of points around this point, and you look, as you increase the bubble, how many points that are the attractor you have inside the bubble. This doesn't increase, so if you do this thing, so let's say, let's go slow. So you take a point, suppose that you have a plane in two dimensions, in three dimensions, right? You take a point of the plane, you take a bubble in three dimensions, and you look how many points of the planes you have as you increase the size of the bubble. The number of points in the plane increases quadratically with the size of the bubble, with the radius of the bubble, right? The fact that it's increasing quadratically tells you that the plane is two-dimensional, okay? If you add some hypervolume, a three-dimensional hypervolume in six dimensions, and you do the same thing, the number of points in this three-dimensional hypervolume increases as the cube of the radius of the bubble, okay? If you have a line in two dimensions, okay, which is the only thing I can draw, and you take one point, okay, and you look at bubbles of different size, you can ask how many points do I have as I increase the radius of my bubble, okay? Of course, the points you have grows as the radius of the bubble, linearly, okay? Quite contemporary to Lorentz, there was a guy named Mandelbrot who looked at the coastline of, I think, the UK. So you have the coastline, right? This is like the land, this is the sea, okay? And you have this line, and you can repeat the same analysis, okay? And if you repeat the same analysis, what you find is that this line grows with some exponent, which is not one. Okay. Now imagine that you do the same here. Here what you do is that you find an exponent which is not 2 and is not 1, is in between 1 and 2. Okay? Meaning that as you move away you have a structure which doesn't have, which is not a line in two dimensions, is not a plane, is something with a dense structure, but that is in between the two. Okay? I cannot say it any better than this. Okay? So, the only point I want to make is that strange attractors are strange and interesting from a mathematical point of view. Are also, the other point of view, are also very beautiful to see. So I'll put some pictures in Slack. Because I think it's very remarkable how my drawing abilities, you know, they're not great. But it's very remarkable how from very simple equations, which are not to be linear, of course, but in this case it's just quadratic. So you take three-dimensional equations with very simple structures, you end up and you integrate these over time. What you do is take these equations, you integrate over time, and then you look at the points of like z versus x, which is basically what I'm doing here because I projected it on this plane. So you look at z versus y over time and you see these beautiful pictures emerge. Okay? And these beautiful pictures are the projection of the attractor on the plane. And fundamentally, the reason why they are beautiful is exactly because they are fractal, right? Because they are not two-dimensional objects, but it's because they have this granularity structure, which made them appear also beautiful. But they are also interesting mathematics. So I didn't say. And then I'll stop. Anything about ecology in this part of chaos. The only thing I want to say is there are systems of three or more equations that you can write in ecology that they exhibit this kind of behavior. Okay? And so you look at the dynamics of populations over time according to the system and you see the chaotic behavior. Okay? So next time what we're going to do is to look at how chaos can emerge in much simple system that are not differential equations, and then you'll see what we're going to do. And then I want to take a bit, so just to, okay, let's map the road. So what I want to do next is to have almost one lectures on models in epidemiology. Don't look at me like I'm crazy. because like they are very similar to ecological models, and I think they might be useful to know in this world, and to have an idea of the quantities that people talk about in journals and politics. And then we're going to introduce some stochasticity in ecology, and then we're going to move to evolution. And then many nice things to see. Okay? Any question? Good. Thanks a lot.
Recording stuff.